Welcome to the Radiantpreneur Rising Show with me, Jess Tomlinson. Interviews to inspire a new movement of leaders and entrepreneurs. The ones who lead with vulnerability and authenticity, stand in visibility, allowing themselves to truly be seen, are fierce and playful and sexy. Choose business as a spiritual practice. Seek collaboration versus competition. No giving back is not an option. It's a necessity. They do it their way. They radiate. They rise. Now, let's rise together.
All right. We are recording. Hello, everyone. I'm so excited to dive in to this very, 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 very first episode of Radiantpreneur Rising. And you already heard in the intro, but this is something that is so important to my heart, to my mission to serve people in a greater way, to discover your own visibility and what it means to be a Radiantpreneur. And I'm super stoked to have Mr. Frank Macri here today to talk about his amazing mission that he is creating. And oh my gosh, there's just so much. We were chatting before we got on about several different topics that are near and dear to my heart and also to Frank's. So I'm thrilled to provide you with this interview to dive deeper into his story. And we're just going to kick it off. Sound good, Frank?
Love it. Sounds good. Honored to be here. Namaste to all the listeners.
Namaste. Yes, namaste. And namaste is Frank's movement that he's creating and what he stands for. So we will dive more into that. But I want to start with a question for you, Frank. Mm-hmm. As we go along this theme of visibility, I'm curious, what are some visibility edges that you're pushing for yourself right now?
That's a great question. Wow, we're diving right into it.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I feel like visibility is so tied into my life's purpose. And just every kind of challenge I've faced, edges I've experienced have been around becoming more visible and seen. And mm-hmm. I, even though now I have had the honor of speaking internationally and talking in front of thousands of highly successful people, some of which being very esteemed individuals. One of the people in my workshops was a three-time Emmy Award winner, and I'm going to be sharing the stage with a Hollywood actress in a few weeks at the Namaste Summit. But like, even though that's happening now, and I feel that visibility is why I'm here, I totally struggled a lot with that just growing up, and felt like visibility was the hardest thing. It was the most vulnerable thing. And mm-hmm. I had a lot of challenges around visibility with my voice, the way my voice sounded, sounding feminine, sounding gay, and judging those things as being bad, judging those things as being something wrong about me. So for years, I spent my life hiding and wearing an invisibility cloak and just keeping myself closed off, not letting my true self be seen. And the cost of this was not just, you know, emotionally knowing that I am living into my fear and shame, but physically my body started to react to being invisible. I had so much anxiety that I was diagnosed with a thyroid disease as a teenager. And suddenly my whole world was falling apart, and I worried every day if, you know, I was going to be okay and live a flourishing, healthy, long life. And spiritually, this invisibility caused me to feel like I wasn't living my purpose. Mm-hmm. And then one day I just realized everything in my life was pointing to the same message, and I just wasn't seeing it. But when I finally woke myself up to realize what that message was, it was to stop being invisible. And that was what I needed to hear. That's what I needed to learn. So after just coming out of the closet, being visible in terms of who I am and boldly showing up authentically, all these possibilities opened up for me. Not only did my thyroid heal, which a lot of doctors said never would, but I started to take bigger risks in my life and live with more intention. I started to... I moved across the world to teach English in China for a couple years, which was cool. Incredible, and I traveled all over Asia. And then I started my own business as a professional coach. And from there began to be a trainer of coaches. And now I do a lot of business coaching and leadership development. And I'm just so passionate about visibility and the constant edges it creates for us to show up in bigger and bolder ways. So right now, visibility for me is stepping into my power, leading a very fresh but needed movement with Namaste, and bringing together thousands of purpose-driven LGBTQ people out there. I think I got all the letters, LGBTQ plus people out there who are also struggling with feeling invisible or having trouble sharing their voice, being their authentic, bold self because they're afraid they're not going to fit in, or they're worried they're going to be alone, or they're feeling disconnected from people because they don't fit into the bar, the club scene, or the dating app world. So visibility for me is showing up as a transformational leader and showing that it is possible for LGBTQ people to connect in more meaningful ways.
Wow. That's amazing, Frank. Thank you. There's so much there to unpack. And you and I actually, I know we don't know each other that well, even though we're part of the same program. Frank and I are part of this program called Thrive that is just amazing. I won't go into much here, but look it up if you're curious. And we just met. So I kind of love doing these interviews. Like, I've done many interviews in the past where I like really know the people, and those are cool for one reason, but like, I don't know you that well. And so it's kind of fun for me to learn about you. And one thing that we have in common is the physical ailment from holding back like our voice. For me, what I've come to the root of, I had major like stomach pains for most of my life until I was like in my mid 20s, and I actually started meditating. So namaste. And then yes. And then they went away. But what I came to realize is that it was part connected to my voice and part connected to boundaries, like using my voice to set boundaries, because I was really like a people pleaser, over giver. And I just held all this like anxiety of trying to keep up with the world. And in a way, actually, with us just talking about this, I think that was part of like my invisibility cloak. Was like, that was like safe for me. It was to just be the giver instead of really kind of creating the space for me to be able to shine and rise up into my own leadership. So I'm curious kind of like your thoughts around, what did it take for you once you found out this thyroid diagnosis? Like, what were kind of the steps, if you could walk us through, what did it take for you to kind of like step into that leadership, and how did the healing start to begin so that you could become more visible?
That's a great question too. It just was like a whole bunch of different things pointing to the same choice. And, you know, I had all these things happen for me where, and I think you realize the physical body is just like a messenger to the soul. It tells us what's needing in our life, what we're lacking, what we're not honoring and expressing. And I totally believe in the mind-body connection. And I think for me, it was that there was so much of this pushing, feeling like I was powerless for so long, feeling like the world was pushing against me, that my body was working against me, that my I was destined to not live a full life. And I felt, it wasn't until I had an absolute breakdown before I had the breakthrough. And I think sometimes we need that. So for me, actually, there were a few breakdowns. One of them was kind of when I was going through a lot of health anxiety and had all this hypochondrosis. That's a really, I taught English for 2 years. I'm retired, so I'm not going to get that word. Hypochondriasis.
We'll forgive you. Oh, wow.
I think that's the word. I was a hypochondriac. And I was so in my head about my health. And then I one time was faced with the possibility of having cancer. And I saw it in my blood work, but I was never informed by a doctor about it. So I found out alone months after the blood work happened. And here was me facing my biggest fear of like, actually my life is going to end and there's nothing I can do. And I needed to face that breakdown in order to step into my power and realize that I always have a choice. I always have a choice in how I show up. I have a choice in how I relate to my body. And I love now that I feel that way in all areas of life, not just with my health. So as leaders, I believe we always have a choice in how we show up, how we show up to circumstances, how we show up to our doubts, how we show up when it comes to having certain resources. And we can choose to buy into that, and we can also choose to not buy into that. So what for me has worked really well is choosing to live intentionally and having a lot of fun in the process. Mm. So namaste is a birth of not just mindfulness, but also playfulness. So it's about let's be mindful and also realize that we can go deep and uncover some of those, you know, more vulnerable feelings and thoughts and have a lot of fun around it. We had, you know, recently, going off of what you were talking about before, I recently led a group meditation in Seattle, and we talked about the masks that we wear, how we all kind of carry around in a cloak or a mask, and it's a way that we show up to fit in. And you said for you it was being the giver, giver, giver all the time. And we all have some kind of mask that we wear, but when we take down the mask and really just discover that people want that, they crave that, they need that, so many things open up for us. So we did that meditation, and I remember this one man who was there, he was just in awe at the fact that everyone had a mask that they had owned up to. He thought he was the only one who had tried to hide behind a mask his entire life. And just in, from that meditation, he was able to realize he doesn't need to wear the mask anymore. He can actually be seen and visible and still loved and embraced by people.
Wow. Wow, that's so inspiring. And it's like, you know, we don't just have one mask. Like, I know I still have masks. I probably have layer upon layer. And like, because we do this like deeper work, which is really what being a leader and what I call a radiantpreneur is all about. Is diving in, right? Like, what is that next layer so that I can show up and be more powerful? And that's amazing about that man, because like, I can't even conceptually think that like other people would think that they're alone. Like, I just can't even, I'm just like, everybody's got masks on. Like,
I have a whole closet of masks.
Right? Yeah. So like, what, I'm curious, when, before you really kind of stepped into this place of leadership, what was your favorite mask to wear?
I really liked wearing the Jim Carrey mask, you know, from the
movie. Funny guy.
And I liked wearing the Jekyll and Hyde mask. No. oh my gosh, what was my favorite mask to wear? I think the favorite mask was the mask of perfectionism. Everything's perfect.
Oh my God, same. Yeah.
Everything's great. Everything's fine. I call fine the four-letter F word, and I call it out all the time with my clients, because when we say it's fine, it's fine, it's fine, it's not. We're actually just, you know, like polishing a turd, for lack of a better way to describe it. It's like, it's all shiny and bright and looks great, and we're going to call it fine, but really, there's a lot of crap there that's painful and messy and gross, and we don't want it in our life. I carried around the perfection mask and I would call it maybe a tolerations mask for a long time. I'm going to call it fine and tolerate relationships and work that's good enough. And then I realized toleration is still an expenditure of energy. It takes energy to tolerate people and situations and circumstances that are good enough, when that energy could be put to creating something more amazing. So after letting go of the toleration and the it's fine, everything's perfect, and just getting real with myself about where I need support, where I want to grow, and actually asking for that support, because that was another mask. It was the mask of I can do it by myself. I started to have all these great things happen. I got support from Thrive, like you said. I hired business coaches. I had worked with therapists. I feel like I have this amazing support team, and we all need that community to thrive. We all need that. It's one thing to have a vision. It's another thing to have other people to share your vision with. So when it comes to big things like the Namaste Summit, I mean, that's why we were so happy to hire you and Ben, because you both are sharing in the vision of Namaste, and you're going to be there to record and capture that weekend, which is beautiful. But had I not realized how important it is to ask for that help and support, because when you have a big mission, you need big support, then it wouldn't have happened. And I feel like we all need that in our life. We need to put down the mask, know that it's okay to not be okay, and we deserve the best support that we can get. And that's why I'm passionate about our LGBTQ community with Namaste, because it's so hard. It's to just go through life trying to be inspired, but when you find your purpose and the community to share your purpose with, oh my gosh, it just uplifts so many things, and it has for so many of our members.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, there's so much good stuff here. Yeah, and thank you for mentioning that Ben and I are coming to film your summit. We're so grateful. Ben's my partner, for anybody that doesn't know. He's the genius videographer, and I'm just like, you know, the one over here doing the song and dance.
You both are a powerful, powerful couple, and just work couple. Great, great dynamic you both have. It's such a privilege to be partnered with you both.
Oh, thank you. It's like a whole, you know, speaking of the visibility, it's like a whole new level when you have somebody else. Like, I feel like this is like a whole other topic of an interview, you know, when you have somebody else that you're creating with. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, like, it has challenged me to a new level of visibility, which is something you mentioned, which is asking for support. Like, here I have this amazing business partner, and he's newer at this. You know, I've been doing it for 8 years as a coach in many different areas of supporting women. And now he's here, like, hungry. And I'm like, I don't know what I need. Like, he even just said it before we got on this interview. He's like, babe, do you need anything? And I was like, no, I'm good. So I want to dive into that a little bit, because I think it would really serve the people watching this. You know, this whole idea, and you and I'm resonating with your story so much. Like, we could talk for hours about this. It's like, as a culture, you know, I feel like, at least, I don't know, in the US, I'm being maybe ignorant here, but, or naive. I feel like it's a common concept of, like, when you do it alone, there's like this like badge of honor, you know? And is that like, do you want to say more about that for you?
Oh my gosh, there's so much to go into. I don't think that's ignorant. I think that's part reality for just where we are as a society. When I went to China, I saw just how people, it was all about the community. It was all about the shared collective unit. And I was so confused about that. I thought, wait, why aren't people more independent? And then I realized it wasn't about that. It was about, let's all lean on the community, the unit, the tribal unit. Mm-hmm. And there's so many things happening now with technology and how it's in one way disconnected everybody. But in other ways, now we're seeing, it's actually, people are finding tribes through digitizing or bringing together people through social media or through digital platforms, like Meetup, for example. That's been a great way of bringing together the Namaste community, is through meetup.com. We use Facebook. And I think that, yeah, there's so much of this. Do I really need to do something by myself to feel worthy and valuable? I carried that belief for a long time. And I think it's actually an act of self-love, and it's an act of service to be able to welcome support. Because when you welcome support, it's filling your cup up even more, which has postured me in a way where I'm more abundantly able to share what I want to share. But if I did it by myself, I'm actually lowering the impact and service I can give to people. So there's that. And then there's also spiritually, I believe that the universe is listening. It's listening to what we're putting out there. And the universe might, you know, turn up the hearing aid, but she's always there and she's listening, and it's always kind of tuning into the signals we're putting out. And if we're putting out a signal of, yeah, I don't really want to invest or get the resources I need, then the universe is like, oh, okay, so you don't really care. You're not really in this. So that wishy-washy energy for me for years got matched with wishy-washy opportunities. And then when I said yes to support and yes to investing and yes to just getting the proper care I needed to thrive, yeah. The universe was like, oh, okay, so you are committed right now. And with that being said, here's an abundance of amazing opportunities for you. And that's where things started to really grow for me as a coach, as a speaker, as a trainer, and as the founder of Namaste. It was starting with the asking for help and investing in my personal mission.
Yeah, so good. So I'm curious, because for you, this community that you're creating, I hate that I have to say, like, it's so special. Like, wouldn't it be cool if, like, there's a day where it's just, like, normal? Okay, but I digress, right? And at the same time, like, it's really special what you're creating. And I know that you and I, in a previous conversation, we were talking about how your people are sometimes a little more, like, introverted. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious how you create, because we're talking a lot about, like, lean into support and community. And what I've learned over the years, that my clients need, which is something that it took me a really long time to realize because I'm such a trusting person, but they need trust. Like, people have been burned and bruised and they barely trust themselves. So why should they trust, you know, leaning into support from people that they don't know or a community that might, like, burn them? So what do you do to create trust?
That's a great question. So first of all, just, it reminds me of one of the clients I worked with, and she was struggling a lot with the idea of trusting someone else. Mm-hmm. And she tried to carry her vision by herself. I think she was looking to start a business, and trust was a big thing because of her upbringing with her family, with parenting. There was a lot of trust that was broken. Mm-hmm. And when we were able to work together, what came up was that we really don't ever trust another person. That's kind of a story. Like, I'm going to trust you. That's not actually real. The only thing we trust in is our ability to choose what we need, and trusting in our ability to get up if we fall down, and trusting in our ability to rise if something doesn't go our way. So it's all a matter of trusting in the journey we create, not about the people or things that come into that journey. It's about trusting in you. And when the client realized that, it opened up a lot for her, because then she was able to trust business decisions that were previously hard for her because she was all focused on, can I trust them? When it really was about, I just need to trust in me and trust what my soul is telling me. And if something doesn't go how I expect, I trust that I'll get it on track again. So when it comes to building community in Namaste, we do, you know, encourage our community to connect to that kind of trust where they're able to have that self-trust come up for them. And there's a way that we help facilitate that. So we are very inclusive when it comes to just, because it's kind of like when you think of a tribe, there's, I often will say, like, there's, when it comes to what is a tribe, what do we really need to feel trusted by a tribe of people? Well, it's kind of like just answering the question, do I feel safe? Do I feel supported? And do I feel seen? Which is a theme of what we're talking about. So do I feel safe? Do I feel supported? And do I feel seen? And if people are feeling safe, supported, and seen, then that's a foundation of trust in any relationship, in any community. So at our events, you know, we have some shy, introverted people who have gone through a lot of really tough life experiences. Our members, you know, go from 20 all the way to 75. There's a whole gamut age range. And they've grown up in very different experiences when it comes to being in the LGBTQ community. So it's very different, obviously, if you grew up in the 90s versus if you grew up in the 60s. Being in our community. So a lot of our members, when they're first coming to an event, I remember we did a kickoff in Seattle, and this one woman was totally not opening her mouth the whole time. She was sitting in the back, wasn't saying much, just kind of looking around. I could tell she was kind of scoping out the room. And then we did a few exercises, and at the end of the event, she raised her hand. And I asked her, you know, to share what was on her mind. And she said, you know, Frank, I was really skeptical at first coming here because I've had a lot of trouble trusting in finding communities. I just came out of the closet and I had trouble trusting where I could find the people to really get me. I didn't want to go to a club or a bar. That didn't really fit with who I am and what I value. Yes. But after coming to this event, I feel like I finally found that community that I can trust, that I can lean into. And now I feel more energized and hopeful to be able to show up more freely because I know that there are people out there like me. And she ended up signing up for the summit immediately, which was so cool. But that's why trust is so important and why make it a foundation when it comes to bringing together community.
Yeah. Did she say what it was that like helped create that trust?
She kind of referenced that it was just kind of feeling seen. It was being supported and it was being heard in this group. So we do a lot of fun type of, some of our events are more social, getting people connecting. Others are more inward where we're doing more of the meditation and centering exercises. So this was a little bit of both. And I think it was just kind of the energy of the group and the experience she had that allowed her to feel like she could open up, and also the other people that were there. So yes, it shouldn't be special, but there is something very special about like seeing this community come together because it's kind of like there were all of these people scattered, just kind of in their bubble waiting for something like this. And then when it's finally here, like when I created Namaste, I didn't know how it was going to land. But then all these thousands of people started joining and I just went, wow, there are other people who want this. Yeah. And like we all came from our, like out of our caves and out of our homes. And here we are showing up with just this enormous feeling of we're here, you know, we can finally find those like-minded, purpose-driven, mindful, compassionate people who value deep connection.
Yeah. I love that. And I have to mention that you're in my hometown of Seattle, so I'm so excited that we get to come and film your summit, which is April 20th through the 22nd, right?
That is right. 3-day, fun, powerful, transformative event. It's for our most purpose-driven leaders in the LGBTQ community in the Namaste world. And we are so excited. We're going to have lots of speakers there. There's going to be lots of ways to connect with other mindful leaders in the community. And I just can't wait for you to be a part of that and for this to be a tradition that we do every year.
Yeah, awesome. Well, I'm really excited too. And I think like the one last thing that I really want to touch on is there's just something about this like creating a safe community, and it just feels extremely important and potent, especially for the queer spiritual crowd. If that is the appropriate term, please correct me if it's not. And anybody who really falls into the LGBTQ community that you're creating. I love how you pulled together these two dynamics that are still like rife with judgment in society. And it's like two things, right? So like, I really, really honor you. And I swear we could talk like forever about like, how do you create trust and safety? And like, I love to geek out on this kind of stuff. But I think I really want to say that I honor you for doing that. And it's so necessary. Like from my own experience, I've led TEDx events, TEDx women, you know, TED Talks.
Yes.
Those events, three of them in Las Vegas when I lived there. And from bringing those speakers together and then also having my own women's circle that was a spiritual women's circle that was kind of like underground that I hosted at my home, what I noticed in those kind of communities that I've created is that for me, standing in my own vulnerability, leading from vulnerability is what kept those groups feeling safe and together when I was the example.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find that in your community too?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Yeah. I love that you're saying that. Leading with vulnerability and taking off the mask gives other people that permission to do it. And I found that just in doing all these hundreds of events and trainings and workshops over the years, that the more that I lead with that vulnerability and showing like it's okay to not be perfect and polished and professional all the time. Like there's a picture I back here that fell off the wall, which we were joking about before, and it's okay. We could be seen and still be awesome rock stars in our worlds. And I love that you mentioned that, because vulnerability is such a trust builder. I think vulnerability is a love magnet as well. We see it as sometimes.
I love that.
That was a new rule I made for myself, because I was living for years thinking vulnerability was a weakness or a bad thing. And when it came to intimate relationships, I totally closed off emotionally. Like, I'm not going there. I'm not going to say how I really feel. I'm going to let them tell me if they're interested in me first, so I don't risk being hurt or rejected. I wasn't being a creator of my life. I wasn't creating safety. I wasn't creating trust. I was waiting for it to be given to me. So in order, I think safety, and we could geek out about it, has different layers. There's like the physical safety where, you know, we don't really struggle with as much as the times when, you know, like we're not going through the jungle and having lions and tigers run up and trying to kill us. But there's more of this emotional, spiritual safety that that when we realize we create that for ourselves, we create that emotional safety because we're whole and full no matter what happens out here. When we come from that place and we could give ourselves permission to be vulnerable, then it allows the truth to come into our life. It allows deeper connection to come into our life. So when I started to try that out on dates, and I would tell, you know, if I was with a guy, I'd say, this is really vulnerable and I feel really uncomfortable sharing, but I'm really interested in you and I would love to keep connecting, and I just love where this is going, and I appreciate so many things about you. Every single time that's happened, it's like created this magnetism, this trust, this safety. And not to say those relationships worked out, but it's not about that. It's about I'm leading with the energy I want to attract in my life. Yeah. So when you put the vulnerability, the trust, and the safety, you lead from it and you create space for it, you're going to start to attract people who are going to fit and resonate with that.
I love that so much. Oh my gosh. And there's so much layers to vulnerability. And I love, Brené Brown obviously is like a huge, huge, cultivator of the movement for vulnerability. And I love how she says in her book, I think it's Daring Greatly, probably, with all the vulnerability research, but she says like, it's the number one thing we crave from each other, and it's also the number one thing we are freaked out to share and to like show. It's like this crazy oxymoron, right? Of like, what is happening when if we would all just like really surrender? And this is where I believe it all comes back to trust. Like, I'm gonna be okay. Like, if I share this, it's actually gonna bring me closer. And if it doesn't, it's okay. Like, if, you know, this community rejects me or if this person rejects me, it's not a reflection of me. It's like, I'm going to be okay because I trust so much in myself that I know I have the resources, the support, the whatever, you know, to make it through.
I mean, that's beautifully said. And it's kind of like, well, what's the cost if we're not vulnerable? Because it can be painful and hard to be vulnerable. That's part of the game of vulnerability. But what's the cost of living life not? Well, we wear the mask. We don't get to be really seen and heard as we are. Mm-hmm. We shrink down to fit in. We tolerate relationships and circumstances that don't align with our values. And this is a huge problem in the LGBTQ community. There's a lot of feeling like you need to be drunk or high in order to open up to someone, or you need to have sex in order to feel connected, or you need to, you know, be a certain stereotype in order to fit in. And that's not true. That's all a way that we shrink ourselves down in order to not be vulnerable at the cost of of living our truth and attracting all of these things out there, deeper love, amazing connection, incredible opportunities. We miss out on that when we don't give ourselves the opportunity and choice to be vulnerable. And it can be hard to do it alone. So that's why when, and I don't want to see, you know, like the summit go by and then people or years go by and LGBTQ plus people feel like, oh, I just wish I had a community. I wish I had that. And I missed out on so many years of my life feeling lonely, feeling disconnected, feeling afraid to be who I am. Yeah. And, when years and years go by and we realize we had that choice, it could be even more painful for us to think like, oh, if only I said yes to community. And this could sometimes be the hardest thing we do. Just to tell you a quick story. When I moved to Vancouver a few years ago, I wanted to meet new people. And it was vulnerable to do that, to put yourself in a new group. And being an introverted person, I just sometimes prefer to stay on my couch.
You're an introvert?
What? I'm totally an introvert. Yeah. I love getting my time where I'm on the couch, watching my YouTube, drinking my tea from my Namaste cup, available at namaste.com. Shameless plug. And I love that. I get energized from having the solitude. But I love socializing. I just intentionally... I am intentional about my energy when I'm in social settings. So I, for a long time, just didn't have that support group. I didn't have that community, the friendship. And I finally saw that there was a gay men's running group in Vancouver. And I don't really run, but I thought, okay, here I am. Let me try to at least make an effort. So I went to the park they were meeting at, and I saw them all standing in a circle. They didn't see me yet. And I was kind of taking a few steps forward and then a few steps back. And then I turned around and I said, I think I need to go home because it's so painful to feel like I'm going to be rejected. Wow. So I started to walk home and I saw the group get ready to start running. And then something came over me and I said, you know what? It's going to cost me so much more to not show up at this group event because I'm going to go home feeling lonely. I'm going to continue to feel like I'm missing out on connection and opportunities. And I'm going to feel like I didn't really create the life I wanted. So I turned around, I went up to the group, and within a minute, I shared who I was, and I felt connected to this whole group of new people. And by the end of the running that we did, when I was disgusting and sweaty and exhausted, I had all these friends to just connect with. And it just took that simple choice of saying yes to connection and no to my fears to now be a part of an awesome tribe. So I invite anyone who feels like that's kind of resonating for them to say yes to connection in whatever way that could be, because that's like the gateway to vulnerability. When we say yes to connecting with others, it allows us to show up with more vulnerability. When we say yes to our fears, we're cutting off the opportunity to connect and be vulnerable and be seen.
Oh, that's so good. I'm thinking of like so many stories of my own life, and I'm actually like right in the middle. I'm an ambivert. So I'm like equal extrovert. Everybody assumes I'm just like an extreme extrovert because I'm like a happy person. Right. But I'm with you. I really like my like introverted time, and I'm one of those people. I actually like really like to have somebody like a sidekick when I go to a party. Like I get super nervous, you know? And I think like one thing that helped me, which it's a total mind fuck. Like people sometimes when I share this with clients, they're just like, what, Jess? But it works for me. So I just continue to share it. Mm-hmm. And that is, we are special, but we're not that freaking special. And that's like a relief to me. Like, okay, I'm special. I matter. And I guarantee that that person that you are worrying about, thinking about, assuming that they're judging you are probably not occupying, you're probably not occupying their minds for the entire day as much as like you were thinking about and worrying about them judging you. Yeah. Right? Yeah. Oh,
absolutely. Yeah. And that's one of my favorite quote. One of my favorite quotes, I think when I was a high school senior, we put our quote in the yearbook and I, for some reason chose, everyone is unique. Or like, we all are unique, just like everybody else. Which, you know, like, we're all special, but the fact that we're all special doesn't make us special anymore.
Yes! I freaking love that. Your audience might like that I have read A Course in Miracles a few times. Like, I don't know if you follow any of that, but like that there's this whole section on specialness. And I'm just laughing. I'll share with you real quick that like, I remember going to my first like meetups, speaking of meetups, on A Course in Miracles, and they were talking about this concept of like special, and they related it to like Lord of the Rings, like Gollum. You know how he's like, my precious, like the ring, like, oh, it's so special and precious. And he like, you know, freaks out and like, can't lose the ring. And how that's basically sometimes how we treat relationships, how we treat identity of ourselves, how we treat like how we treat physical things in our life. Like we place so much of our like value on them that it takes away from our own inner power of like, we are like whole and complete beings within ourselves. Like we have all the resources within. So I just thought that that was a really powerful concept. I'm not sure if you appreciate that or not.
I love it. Yeah. I mean, it's like when we choose connection over needing to feel special, we not only let our walls down and focus on others, but we allow deeper opportunities to be vulnerable and seen in our life. But it takes us choosing connection over needing to feel special. And we all are special already.
We are, totally. Yeah, we're not saying, you guys, that you're not special.
We're special, and we can connect over how special we are. How is that? We can all connect about the special ways we can contribute to ourselves to show up with vulnerability. So like when you take the whole significance thing, which we all need to feel special and significant, but look at it, instead of I'm going to just focus on me, I'm going to connect with others in special ways. I'm going to be vulnerable in a special way. I'm going to allow myself to be seen in a significant way. It starts to shift what we get from it, because it's no longer just focused on I, it's focused on the we, the unit, the connection, the tribe.
Yeah. I love that. I think that's a good way to end. Do you have any kind of, I know, I really enjoyed chatting with you, and like, yeah, we could definitely jam on this for a long time. I'm going to have you back once I get the interviews rolling. I'm so honored that you're my first interview, and you really represent, you know, this Radiantpreneur Rising movement that I'm creating. And it's about being a leader, being more visible, leading movements from your heart, from vulnerability, and also doing things differently. You know, a lot of things need to change. So thank you for being one of those amazing leaders. And,
well, thank you. This is an honor. I love what you're about with the Radiantpreneur. I think that is brilliant. And you are just a walking example of heartfelt leadership and entrepreneurship. And I just appreciate the work you do and the messages and stories that you feel inspired to share. And just, you know, your level of connection, it's just very felt. Even though I've known you for a short time, I just feel like I'm really connected with you. So thank you so much for being a part of this awesome podcast that I know is going to thrive. And to the listeners, namaste, and thank you. And if you want to check out the Namaste Summit, then head to namaste.com, and you'll be able to find out about the 2018 Summit. And if you can't make this one, we're going to have another one in 2019. And we have a big engaged Facebook group where thousands of our members connect around the world. So if you search Namaste, you can find us there. And you'll also find this awesome interview with Jess there, because they're going to be capturing the whole summit weekend, which I can't wait for.
Yay! So excited. All right, Frank, thank you so much for taking some time tonight, and I'll see you soon.
See you soon. Namaste.
Namaste.